Good morning. It's a beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
You can tell it's finally getting warmer after the cold winter we had. And just by way of announcement, for Easter Sunday, Sunday school, what I'm anticipating on doing is having an open discussion on proving that Christ really died on the cross, that the resurrection really did happen.
Amen.
That what evidence do we have? Can we prove the resurrection and crucifixion of Jesus Christ through any means other than looking at the Bible as the inspired Word of God? Can we prove that it happened through history? What science backs it up? Any area. So when it comes to Easter Sunday, what we're going to do for Sunday school is, can we prove the resurrection and crucifixion of Jesus Christ actually happened through any means possible other than saying, well, this is what the Bible says. This is what the Bible says. I know that we need to do that in an everyday life when we talk to people. But if somebody's not a believer, how we talked about in the past, how do we prove that Jesus actually existed to someone through not pounding the Bible as the inspired Word of God, but showing that actually happened? Are there any other means? So we're going to do that with the crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ. There was one more I had on the tip of my tongue, and I lost it, as usual. So, we'll carry on. What major topic have we been talking about? We've been looking at it. Evangelism, probably. We've been looking at evangelism. We've been looking at witnessing and reaching out to the lost. And is it just something that we do for fun? Or where does it begin? It's not just something that we wake up one day and say, hey, I'm going to go tell somebody about Jesus. Typically, it's not. But when we look at the Word of God, we see that we are commanded to. And if we are going to be effective in evangelism, where does it begin? It begins with you and me. It begins on a personal level. We sing that song, though we haven't sang it in a while. It was Revival Fire, Let It Begin in Me. When it comes to this Christian walk, it begins with us. And we have to make sure that we're right, that we're ready, that we're prepping, and that we're doing what we have to so we can be effective witnesses for Jesus Christ. When we look at the Word of God, he says the effectual fervent prayer, or the effective prayer, availeth much. If we are going to be successful in evangelism, we have to be effective. If we're going to do anything in life, we have to be effective. If you want to do anything in life, does it normally happen on the first try? It typically doesn't. I said last week, in my own personal life, and it's not in every area really, like, almost seems like I have failed over and over and over again. Because if I would have been successful, I would have been a millionaire by now. Trust me, or a billionaire. And then I could take off and do whatever. But even when we go back to basic math, 1 plus 1, 2 plus 2, there comes a point where we had to fail before we got the correct answer. If we were going to be successful in to take a test, we had to study. And there are some tests that I failed. But what did it take? It took me going back and relearning. It took me putting more effort into it. It didn't just happen like that. In order to be effective, I had to first practice. If we are going to be effective, there's several things that must take place. First of all know we have to be a Christian. Second of all, it really begins in a place of prayer. Because it's the Holy Ghost that deals with men's souls and convict them of their sins. Brother Eli, it doesn't matter how much I know the Word of God, I can quote it verbatim, but as the Apostle Paul said, preaching is foolishness, but yet God uses that to confound the wise. the place that ministers become effective is in a place of prayer. If we are truly going to be effective. People can wow people with words, don't get me wrong, but they're short-lived. If we are truly going to have an impact, it begins in prayer. And after we find ourselves in a place of prayer, then as we did the rest of our life, all growing up, we realize that there's going to be more action on our part that has to be taken. It's not going to happen just like that. I'll probably use this illustration again because, like I said, you get one church, you get an illustration, you use it a million times, and the people are content to hear it over and over again, right? Not really, I joke, but regardless, like I said, hard for preachers to get new material always in the same church, so they hear it over and over again. But regardless, Charles Finney wrote a book called The Power of God. And in that book, he's talking about, he's using his own experiences as examples. And he was talking about, or writing about, in his early life as a Christian, before he became Charles Finney, the evangelist, the revivalist. And he was talking about when he was in, I can't remember if it was just secular college or seminary, but when he was just saved, he wasn't the outgoing person that he was then, at the time of writing the book, but regardless, he said he'd actually go to a local church prayer meeting, Brother Eli. And there he would sit, and week after week, they would pray for the lost, they would pray for this, they would pray for that. But with all their praying, they never put actions behind it. And this went on for a while, and I think he said he was there for about a year, year and a half, until finally a sinner came in and said, if you're that fervent about souls, you pray for them every week, but what do you do to come out to reach us? Faith takes action. If we are going to be effective in evangelism, it's not just prayer, but we have to put actions behind our prayer. Charles Finney said that if you're praying for missions and supporting missions, you better, what steps are you taking to reach out? Are you putting your resources into that area? Are you putting your money, your time, your funds? If you're praying for the sick, are you going out and laying hands on praying for them? Are you just praying for them? He said, if we are going to be effective in our prayers, we need to be applying whatever resources we have as much as possible. Evangelism is the same way. If we are going to be effective, yes, we must pray. Yes, we must get anointed of God. But we have to put actions behind our prayers. When revival strikes, it is, I've said this before, it's either going to explode or it's going to implode. If it implodes, it means that everybody's having a move of God in the church, but they're not doing anything with it. It's all for themselves. They're keeping it, and then it dies. But if it explodes, then people start getting saved, and souls getting changed. What's happening when revival explodes? People are telling people about Christ. It's not just the Holy Ghost moving, but people, the church people, are going out and winning the lost for Christ. It is exploding, it is growing, and God is moving. If we are going to be effective in evangelism, it begins with each one of us. And last week we talked about two different methods that definitely do not work. We talked about the "you're going to hell" approach. That's just a turnoff. And then we also talked about the cardboard sign, poster board sign, the sandwich board sign, whatever you want to call it, where the guy stands on the streets and basically says the same thing. Has a sign, killers of babies go to hell, yada, yada, yada. How effective is that evangelism? It's a turnoff. Because we are telling them what's wrong, but all we're doing is giving condemnation. We're not giving them any hope. And we're just telling them what's wrong. In all honesty, if we look at it from our aspect, and we sit down in any area of our life, and somebody tells us that we're doing wrong, how do we feel about that in general? We don't take it too well. Maybe some of us take it better than others. But the fact of the matter is, if you tell me that I'm doing wrong, then show me a better way. And do it in a loving manner. Well, let me show you how to do this. There's a whole big difference between, you're doing it wrong. You need to stop doing that right there because you're not even doing it right. Or the manner of taking over and just doing it. There are ways to approach people. And we need to do it in a manner of love. Now there are probably two main methods that I can think of off the top of my head that we will be discussing. How many different methods are there to evangelism? There are all different kinds. And it's important for us to get our own method. Not every method is going to be the same. Some might use the Roman throw to a T. Someone might use Ray Comfort's method to a T. Some might take a combination of both and use what's best for them. Not every time you knock on the door, maybe you won't open it up the same way. Do you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior? If next door, or if you die right now, do you know where you're going? It might not be the same method every time, but what is important is that you get it and make it your own. That you go back and you review it. That you get it down. That you come up with your own technique that works for you, because what works for me might not work for you. What works for you might not work for me. Because we're all different. But can anyone off the top of their head name any verses that they might think of that might deal with evangelism when it might be when it comes to leading someone to Christ? Don't need to know the reference.
Go ye into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature.
That is our command. But if you knock on someone's door, or you see somebody in public, what might be one verse you might use to show them that their need for Jesus Christ? At any point, it doesn't have to be in order. What's one verse we might be able to use?
That's in John 3:16.
John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. You know that God loves you so much that he sent his only Son to die on a cross for you and me. No other reason. And when we look at the reason that Jesus Christ came, despite all of his ridicule, he came for no other reason but to find you that you could spend eternity with him. That's the only reason he came. What are some other verses? What does any of them say? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know what? You sinned, I sinned at one point in my life, but Jesus died, Brother Craig, for you. He came for you and I. We were lost, there was no hope. But he came because he knew that I couldn't die for myself and you couldn't die for yourself. It was only through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. We've all sinned. What was the other one you said? Wages of sin is death. And all this time, all your sins that you've been accruing, everything you've been doing against God, has been building up in a bank account until one day we put it out in full. Either we'll get wrath, or we'll get good things. You know, today is the day of decision. What are you going to do with it? One of the most famous methods of leading people to Christ, at least that I can remember in this church, is we've talked about the Romans Road in years past. I don't remember. I think we used to. Do we have a pamphlet in the back at one point with the Romans Road on it? I think we did in our track. But the Romans Road is one of the most famous methods of leading people to Christ. They claim it is simple yet powerful, and as a when it comes to explaining why we need salvation, how God provided salvation, and how we can receive salvation. And what are the results of salvation? The very first verse that they like to look at is Romans chapter 3 and 23. If we'd all turn there. Romans Romans 3:23, and if someone would please read that. When we look at this verse, and before I go any farther and I forget, does everybody have a handout of the Romans Road? I gave it out like 2 weeks ago. Does anybody need the Romans Road? You guys need it? Do you have it, Brother Terry?
I'm not sure.
I have another copy. Anyone else? Marie?
I don't know.
You don't have it?
Yeah, I have it.
You have it? So when we look at the Romans Road, we start out with, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." This is just a short run through of the Romans Road and what they have, but it begins with showing us our need. You can never be saved or realize that you need salvation until you realize you have a need for it. Now, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You have sinned, I have sinned, we've all sinned. And we have all done things that are displeasing to God. And there is only one, and there is no one innocent. There is not one person alive that is not guilty of sinning against God. We've all done it. And if they question it, well, what does the Bible say? This is one of those, when we're talking about salvation, this is where we found the Bible. We were going to prove things happen. We can get away from it. But when it gets down to showing people the Bible, we pound the Bible. Well, I think I'm a good person, but what does the Bible say? It says, "For all have sinned." Well, so-and-so's a good person. Well, what does the Bible say? "For all have sinned." All. Not just some, but all. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You've done that. Even I've done that. And when we look at Romans chapter 3, verses 10 through 18, the Bible gives a detailed picture of what sin looks like in our lives. I'll go ahead and read that. Romans 3. Romans 3, verses 10 through 18. "As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one." We just told them that for all have sinned and there's no one righteous. And it starts off with, there's not one righteous. "There is none that understandeth, there is none that seeketh after God, for they are all gone out of the way, they are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. The throat is an open sepulchre, which their tongues, they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes." So there is no one that is innocent. They are all guilty. They're quick to shed blood. Their mouths are full of deceit, cursings, bitterness. We've all sinned. And when we look at the second scripture of Romans, it is Romans 6 and verse 23. If someone would please read that, or do you have still have a handy? Someone please read 6:23. "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." When we look at this passage here, it shows us the consequences of sin. We talked about that earlier. You know, everything that we do, we're accruing a paycheck in heaven. Either it's going to be good deeds or bad deeds. For the individual that we're talking to here who does not know Christ, you know, you've been laying up a paycheck in heaven, but it's not a good paycheck because it's full of God's wrath. And the more sin that you commit, the more things are piling up against you. And there's going to come a day that that check is going to be paid in full to you. And if you do not accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you're going to experience the wrath of God. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's not just a physical death, but it's an eternal death. It is eternal separation from God Himself. Then we move on to the third verse of the Romans Road. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, they go back to the end of it. They said, right here, God shows us that He's given us a gift. Now, we've been accruing bad things our entire life, but God has a gift for us if we would only accept it, and that is eternal life through Jesus Christ. In Romans chapter 5 and verse 8, if someone would please read that. You know, that paycheck that's constantly being accrued is storing up God's wrath. But He's given us a gift that while we were yet sinners, He sent His only Son to die on the cross for you and I. Even though we've cursed God, we've done things that displeased Him, we've sinned, God still sent His only Son to die on the cross for you and I, that we may have eternal life and spend eternity with Him. Jesus died for us for no other reason but that God loves us. And He paid the death price for our sins. There on the cross, He was the only innocent one that could pay that price, and He did it for us. That's what happens when I start talking. And His resurrection proves that God accepted Jesus Christ's death as the payment for our sins. The resurrection is important because it is the one thing that sets Christianity apart from everything else. It's the fact that our quote-unquote founder is no longer in the grave. He rose just like He said He would. And then we go to Romans chapter 10 and verse 9. If someone would please read that, Romans 10, 9. We show them that they couldn't pay the price. We show them that there was only one. And now we're showing them how to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. This is what the Bible states, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that He raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Because of Jesus' death on your behalf, all we have to do is believe in Him, trusting His death as the payment for our sins, and we will be saved. Then we move on to Romans 10 and verse 13, where it states it again. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Not just some people, but everyone. Now the Bible states that if you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins. If you declare Him and accept Him as your personal Savior, He didn't say He will only accept some. But He said, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That's everyone. Jesus died to pay the penalty for your sins and my sins, and to rescue us from eternal death, that we may spend eternity with Him. Salvation, the forgiveness of sins, is available to anyone who will trust in Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior. And then we get to the final part of the Romans Road. Romans chapter 5 and verse 1. If someone would please read Romans 5, 1.
Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ.
If we establish a relationship with God, we can experience a peace like never before, because we've been made right through our belief in Him. And then Romans 8 and verse 1, what does that teach us? You know, you might have been once a sinner, but if you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, God has nothing else against you anymore. Jesus has wiped it away with His precious blood. And then finally, because of Jesus' death on our behalf, we will never be condemned for our sins. They have been wiped completely away. And then we have the final promise from God in Romans chapter 8, 38 through 39, where the Bible states, "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." No, nothing can separate us from the love of God. No, we've accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. No, there's nothing that no one or anything in this world can do to separate us from the love of God. Now here, if it was me personally, I'd tweak it a little bit and throw in the aspect that the only individual that can take you away from God is you. And the reason being is eternal security. People, they like to use this verse to prove eternal security. But point out to them real quick that, no, God has saved us. But you still have the decision. You could walk away. However you want to phrase it, I just don't like how they... That's just me. And then they have a simple prayer for them to follow there at the end. Like I said, you're going to have your own method, but that is the Romans Road. I say in a nutshell, but that is the kit and the caboodle. Yeah, on paper if you want to go over it, because like I said, when it comes to evangelism, when it comes to reaching the lost, we will develop our own method, I'm sure, but it takes practice. It takes developing. We just talked about last week about when you knock on a door, you can't just go knocking on the door and just stand there with your twiddling your thumbs, not knowing what to say. But you're gonna have what do you want to say when they open the door? Or where do you want to go with anything? Do you want to invite them to church? What are your goals? You know, what are you planning to do? And we've seen all this for the most part in the Romans Road, how to lead someone to Christ. So that'll give you an outline, and you have that to follow. Next week, we'll talk about Nate Krupp's method on reaching the lost. But it is imperative that we do so. Because we are commanded to build the kingdom of God. And the more that we look around us, we see that time is quickly fading away. Not just in our own lives, because I've realized the older we get, the faster time seems to fly. But in general, the world's getting more and more wicked. We're hearing more and more things about people trying to establish a one world religion. We see more of the one world government coming into play. When we look at the chip cards and credit cards they're handing out now, we can see them that shift towards a cashless society. We see the rise of Islam, and not that it hasn't been rising before, but actually to the point where the large having a lot larger influences on governments and countries. Regardless of what you think the one world religion would be, we see that the time of the end is quickly approaching, and Jesus Christ is coming back any moment. And as much as we love to rejoice, and the fact that Christ has come back at any moment, and